Everybody, this is Azure Sword 1, and preemptively I want to apologize for any background noise you might hear. All of the windows are currently open, and the birds are singing. But I wanted to show you guys my sustained industry for the months of May through October of 2021. Starting with the manga, for those of you who know anything about the history of sustained industry so far, throughout the life of the channel, you'll know that I never really bothered buying the Naruto manga in any order. So whenever a new volume would appear in my local bookstore, that is the one that I would buy, or whichever one had the coolest looking cover, or had a particular fight or story arc that I wanted to reread in the form of the manga, I would go for that. This has, unfortunately for me, left a lot of holes in my Naruto manga collection, which I am just now trying to fill up. So these volumes correspond to the second attempt at retrieving Sasuke with the fight with Orochimaru on the bridge and meeting back up with Sasuke for the first time. And then from here to about here is the fight with Hidan and Kakuzu, Asuma, Shikamaru showing off exactly how freaking smart he is. And then these correspond to the Sasuke breaking away from Orochimaru and forming Team Hebi. Now, the other one is the Vizbig, Volume 4, for Inuyasha. Now, I'm a huge fan of Rumiko Takahashi's work. I've read Urusei Yatsura. I own all of Ranma 1/2 in the Blu-ray special edition release. So getting all of Inuyasha, I already have it on DVD, so getting it on manga is the logical next step. Next up are the DVDs, and some of these I feel better about my purchases than others. There are stories behind them, and I hope you will bear with me. So for those of you who don't know, I own all of Dragon Ball Z Kai up to the end of the Cell Saga, but I needed to get the final chapters, which are the Buu Saga. I just needed to find them for cheap. So when I finally saw them, they were online on Amazon on sale, I jumped on the opportunity to get volumes 1 and 3. I'm missing volume 2. Much to my chagrin, one of them is an old library edition. You can imagine why that's frustrating for me. Mainly because it clashes with my entire shelf aesthetic, you know. But nevertheless, the discs work, so that's fine. I'll probably replace it with a better, newer copy without these logo things eventually. But for now, I have parts 1 and 3. Hero Tale is a underrated and maybe not unwarranted. It isn't an amazing series, but it is a really good, entertaining one. Co-authored by the same woman, Hiromu Arakawa, who did Fullmetal Alchemist, which should be obvious based off of the character designs alone. It's short. It's a very self-contained mythos surrounding reincarnates of constellation-based celestial fighters in alternate version, I think, of China. A lot of, like, politicking, magic, prophecy, big fights. It's good. You know, it feels a little bit, ironically, like Sailor Moon, in that there are these predestined celestial-based fighters, each corresponding to a constellation, that need to take sides in this epic battle between good and evil. Yeah, but it's good. It's good. It's a very catchy theme song, much catchier than it really should be. So if you guys have not seen it, I do recommend you at least, you know, give it a few watches, first 3 or 4 episodes. If you're not hooked by then, well, at least you gave it a shot. Sailor Moon, this is Sailor Moon R, Season 2, Part 2. So this rounds out Season 2 of Sailor Moon. You guys know that I'm trying to get the entirety of the show, which means I'll probably be in the hole $200, maybe? More. Like $300. Sometimes I forget how many seasons there are in this bloody show. Now behold my second biggest regret. This is a library edition of Gankutsuo, The Count of Monte Cristo, which is in terrible condition. Terrible. Terrible condition, and it hurts my soul. Because The Count of Monte Cristo, not only is it an amazing book, which, despite how incredibly long it is very much worth a read. It is one of the best revenge stories ever put to paper. But this anime adaptation, despite the fact that it's set in space France, in an alternate version of the future, and the Count is a bloody vampire, is still, ironically, one of the most faithful adaptations to the spirit of the novel. In terms of the characterization of all of the main cast, the way that the revenge plays out, all of it. Also, artistically, it's going to be hit or miss. I think it's gorgeous. I think that it's one of the most unique feasts for the eyes I've ever seen. It's I wouldn't know how to describe it. You'd have to see it for yourself. Basically, everything is wallpaper. Their hair, their clothes, everything, the way they move, it's so good. And the voice for the Count, God. One of the most both mesmerizing and intimidating voices ever. Unfortunately, the copy that I got looks so bad. It's so ugly, and I'm trying to find a better version of it. If I have to buy it new, it'll be more expensive, but I'll do it because it is that good of a series. It is one of the most underrated anime of the mid-2000s ever. Now, I do want to stress that. It is mid-2000s. The CG has not aged well at all. It really hasn't. But everything else, beautiful. Now my biggest regret. My biggest regret. Hunter x Hunter, the 1999 version, all three parts, all of the series, in one of the most beautiful box sets I have ever seen. I will explain why it is frustrating for me. Now, I'm going to assume that this is mainly going out to an American or English-speaking audience. This is why I am speaking in English. Please do me a favor of reading what it says here. Premier partie, partie de l'intégrale. For those of you who couldn't understand that, that's in French. The whole thing is dubbed in French with French subtitles and, of all variants, Dutch subtitles. No English, no Spanish, nothing that I can understand. I do know a bit of French, but it is not much. Surely not enough to watch the entire series in French. Actually, the dub itself does not sound bad in French. It's just I can't understand very much of it. Je suis très désolé. Mon français n'est pas génial. My French is not that great. So I have to essentially watch this episode by episode, pausing every line or so to read it very slowly in order to piece together what is being said based off of my limited knowledge of French. And what I can't understand by my French knowledge, I have to associate by Spanish cognates. And when that fails me, Google Translate. So this hurts me. This hurts me because it is damn near impossible to find Hunter x Hunter 2019 anywhere from the English release. Anywhere. I have tried in the States, I've tried in England, I've tried in Canada, I've tried in South Africa and Australia and New Zealand, and nothing. Absolutely nothing. The best I can do is bootlegs. I don't want to deal with bootlegs. Let me show you what I mean by this is one of the most beautiful releases I've ever seen. For those of you who remember my reviews of the Death Note and original Bleach Funimation releases, the first three at least. You remember what I said about this style being one of my favorites for its artistic merits? Now, you might be thinking, well, it's a bunch of dots, and, you know, the discs look nice, fine, but... So, the discs are, I should mention, in point of fact, stacked. I can just do this right-handed, unfortunately. So there's another disc underneath, because this covers a lot, so there's six discs, not just three. More importantly, oh, that is nice. That is very, very nice. I will be honest, I actually do prefer the 1999 character designs. I like the older aesthetic. I think that when the series needed to go dark, that animation style and art choice was just better suited for it. I'm looking specifically at the scenes where Kurapika, during the York New City arc, moments where he goes off just are done better. They're handled better in the 1999 version. The scene where Killua rips the heart out of the that one prisoner during the first tournament arc, that's amazing. And it's done so much better in the 1999 version, in my humble opinion. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. A lot of, like, for example, not skipping the introduction of important characters, a bit slower pacing to let you really experience more nuanced and jovial moments with the cast. Things like that handle a little bit better in the 1999 version. And of course, you have the Greed Island arc, which... Actually, I'll be honest, I have not seen the 1999 version of the Greed Island arc, but I have been told that the animation takes a bit of a hit, and so does the pacing, which is unfortunate if true. I will be honest, that would make me very sad. But that notwithstanding, as far as wanting the series, wanting the complete series, I am glad I now have it, even if it is in French. I guess this just gives me a motivation to work on my French. And finally, the Blu-rays that I purchased this month, or these months, plural, my bad. Fruits Basket, the original series from 2001. Still a beautiful series, still very emotionally charged. I would be remiss if I did not mention the fact that it did get a reboot in 2019, I want to say. And in almost all regards, I would say that this version is superior in animation, in music choice, in voice acting, in just everything. And of course, actually getting through the entire manga, covering all of the major story beats. Oh, I will say, though, you could put some of those scenes from either series, like the scene with Momiji's backstory or Hattori's backstory, any of those, I would still probably cry like a bitch, I'll be honest. It gets me every time. And as this series goes on through further parts of season one, bits that this version did not cover, like... bits like Uotani and Hanajima's backstory, those are some of the most heartbreaking. So it is up to you which one. I would say watch this one first, because if you start with this and then you watch this, you're probably going to be a little bit disappointed. But trust me, story-wise, it's all good. It's all beautifully, painfully emotionally charged. And if you don't at least feel a twinge of emotion watching this series, you probably need to go to a psychiatrist to be evaluated for psychopathy or sociopathy. Now, I had previously bought the first season, the first complete season of Black Butler, Kurosho Tsuji. I did not buy season 2 because season 2 is not canon, nor really is half of season 1. There's a lot of filler, but this is all canon. This is Book of Circus, this is Book of Murder, and this is Book of Atlantic. I will say, out of all of these, this one's perhaps the funniest and also the least plausible. I can believe Sebastian can do a lot of things, but running around being both a corpse and a Sherlock knockoff, like that's gotta be pushing the limits of both his willingness to do and his physical capabilities. It just seems a little bit too convenient. Book of Atlantic confused me a lot with its twist at the end. I was deeply confused. And this one is easily the most messed up. Like, yeah, okay, this one has, like, the whole zombie Titanic shtick. Yeah, great. What in the living hell? What in the actual hell? It's just wrong. This, of course, is Demon Slayer. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend you watch it. Stop whatever you're doing and watch Demon Slayer. This is part one of season one. I need to get part two. And as soon as Infinity Train comes out, I am definitely buying it. I already saw it in theaters when it came out here in the States. Destroyed box office records. I'm very proud as an anime fan to have lived through that. Now, what I will say is that this is one of those shows that I have to watch subbed. I don't know if it's Tanjiro's voice. It's just, some of the characters are just not well cast. I don't think their acting is necessarily bad, although it's not often great. It's not usually at the same level as that of the Japanese cast. So maybe it's my American ear, you know, making the Japanese sound better than it actually is because I can't understand it right away. But I'm usually the kind of person that if I can watch it dubbed, I will. Mainly because I want to be able to enjoy the visuals as much as possible without needing to think about reading anything. Sometimes, though, the dubs are just so not good. This isn't terrible. This is not a terrible dub. I've heard some god-awful dubs. This just, I watched it first in Japanese, and it was so good that no dub, I think, could have matched it. So I guess I got spoiled for it. But that notwithstanding, watch Demon Slayer. Come back. You're welcome. This is Fate Stay Night, Heaven's Feel. This is Lost Butterfly, the second movie. So, for those of you who don't know what Fate is a battle royale with mages summoning heroic spirits and legendary historical or mythical characters into the modern world to fight to the death in order to get a magical wish-granting device called a Holy Grail. The animation is some of the best in anything, any anime. You'd have to watch a movie. They get movie-level budgets for their shows. In fact, Ufotable, the same company, does Demon Slayer. So, if you think the animation here is amazing, same guys, same people. Now, the Fate Stay Night series has three separate routes because it was based on a visual novel. The Fate Stay Night route is the romance saber route, and it is generally considered the good or neutral route, with unlimited blade works being also probably either good or neutral. Unambiguously, this is the bad route. This is where all the bad things happen. Horrible things happen in the other versions, don't get me wrong. Like, things that you watch it and you're like, oh, that's fucked up. That's not okay. That's all of this. The Heaven's Feel root is the Sakura root. In case you're wondering, the Unlimited Blade Works is the Rin root. So depending on, in the visual novel, who the protagonist was romancing, it's sort of the story arc. You'd be surprised how much that changes in terms of the story. And my god, this is cripplingly depressing. Nothing makes you happy here. As soon as you think you have a moment of happiness, it is snatched away. And I love it for it. This is the darkest that Fate has gotten. And I started with Fate Zero. Fate Zero is as adult as the Fate series gets, with most of the masters, most of the mages being adults, the main issues being philosophical debates on what it means to be a good ruler, a good king, a good servant, a loyal person, a good friend, whether or not the ends justify the means, and how much can you sacrifice before you are officially on the bad side of morals. It's comparing Kantian philosophy to Hume's philosophy, how much utilitarianism is too much utilitarianism, you know, sacrifice the few for the good of the many. You know, it pushes a lot of this. This doesn't really get that into, like, the philosophy as much as it does how bad can human beings be to each other. Just generally, how depraved, manipulative, cruel, and vicious can human beings be to each other? Turns out quite a lot. Finally, okay, I relented. It was on sale. Rosario Vampires Seasons 1 and 2. Now, those of you who know me know my feelings about the anime in comparison to the manga. The anime's hot garbage, read the manga. That has been my position forever. The manga is an underrated gem, one of the most gorgeous, well-paced, and thought-out manga with real character development that I've read in a very long time. This is not that. This is very much not that. This is shameless fan service and aimless, meandering, episodic plots that go absolutely nowhere, with tangential storylines that don't amount to anything, absolutely zero character development, and any potential for the main character to be anything but a putz is squandered. Can you tell that I don't particularly like it? Well, then why did you buy it, you'll ask? Well, it was on sale for $13, and I am a stupid sucker. It was on sale, and I was like, well, this is both seasons. At least it'll be on my shelf. And I'll be honest, the ending two songs, was it Dance on the Velvet Moon and Trinity Cross, by themselves are sort of worth it. They're both amazing endings by Nana Mizuki, who, by the way, voices Mocha Akashia. Both the Japanese and the English dub are way better than they have any reason to be at all. And that makes me happy. You know, good dubs, good subs, good voice acting in general, with talented voice actors doing a bang-up performance, I'm okay with that. Does it hurt that it was wasted on this and not this? Yeah, I'm not gonna lie. That stings a little. Am I used to it by now? Oh, unfortunately, yeah. So, do I recommend you watch Rosario Vampire? Yes, if only to have a deeper appreciation for what the manga achieved. So I would say, watch the anime first, and then sit down, read the manga, either online, or if you have the money, just buy the whole series on a physical copy like I have, and start reading. And then by maybe volume 2 or 3, you'll be like, what the hell? What in the actual hell, Gonzo? You couldn't be bothered to put a bit more effort into this series? Really? With this as your material? They were working off of a pile of gold, and they turned it into a pile of manure. Well, anyway. My ranting aside, show you guys my purchases for these last few months. They haven't been quite as many as the last batch, which, granted, I had an extra 2 months, and I had nothing to spend my money on other than this. But let me know what you guys thought about my purchases in the comment section below. What did you guys like? What didn't you guys like? What do you guys recommend I check out in the following few months? If you have anything that you guys purchased as well in these last few months, please, of course, share with me in the comment section. Or if you want, make your own video and send it to me so that I can watch you show off your goodies yourself or myself. So I will see you guys later. Adios.